Hi, this is Dilip and welcome to my YouTube channel. And today I'm going to discuss with you a very important aspect of chemistry, and that is school of elements. This is the first chapter of 10th science syllabus of Maharashtra board, and in this chapter I'm going to discuss certain four points which are actually the four important parts of this lesson. Now, first thing is that this whole chapter talks about classification. When we say classification, we actually put certain things in their classes, in their categories, based on certain similarities. Now, the first question is, what is the need to classify? Now, the need for classification arises because we have so many things and it is very difficult to individually study the properties. So we try to find certain commonalities, certain similar features, and we put them in one category so that the process of investigation and the process of study becomes easy, because we have to study only certain groups, and that will give us the fair idea how the particular elements of the group behave. So when this classification of elements started, at that time mainly the elements were classified based on metals and non-metals. But the problem arose when certain elements behaved both as metals as well as non-metals. So there was a need to find out another category in which these elements having the properties of both metal and non-metal can be placed. So this gave birth to the concept of classification. And in this series, the first discovery that was made was by Doberneir. Out of all the known elements at that time, he was able to identify group of three elements which had similar properties. And he studied the atomic mass of these three elements, and he found that the atomic mass of the middle element is always the mean of the atomic mass of the first and the third element. So based on this, he found out certain groups, and these groups obeyed certain properties. The elements of these groups exhibited certain similar properties. So one such group had three elements: lithium, sodium and potassium. Now if the atomic mass of lithium and potassium are added and its mean is found, it is approximately equal to the atomic mass of sodium. So this group of three elements showed certain similar properties, and he called this group triads because they all had three elements. So similarly, he identified certain groups. One such group was chlorine, bromine, iodine, and with the help of this, he was able to classify elements in the groups having three members. But the problem is that not all the elements known at that time obeyed this law of triad. There were certain other elements which deviated, which had different behavior compared to the Doberneir triads. So that was the major limitation which actually led to the next concept of classification, and that was discovered by Newland. And he first arranged all the elements in the increasing order of their atomic mass, and he found that the eighth element in that counting had the similar property as the first element. So using these different methods, he was able to identify certain octaves, which actually got the name from eight components of music, because he said that in the music also every eighth element is repeated. So similarly, he found these elements showing similar behavior. So that's why these group of eight elements are called Newland octaves. though Newland was able to identify a certain group of 8 elements, but even his method had certain deficiencies, certain demerits. Not all the 56 elements showed similar property. He was able to identify elements only up to calcium, which behaved as he predicted, as he suggested. Other elements did not follow the same behavior. Apart from that, later on, when some other elements were discovered, they also did not follow the law or the rule set up by Newland, and this gave a possibility of further improving the classification of elements. And this job was done by Mendeleev, who actually is considered as father of periodic table, because he was the one who used a layout, who arranged all the elements known at that time as per groups, as per periods, and his basis of classification was also atomic mass. So he first put them in the increasing order of atomic mass, and then he started putting them in the different vacant spaces in the table and gave it a tabular form. So even now, the most advanced and the modern periodic table that we see, that is exactly based on the skeleton provided by the Mendeleev's periodic table. And his classification was very much comprehensive. It had all the elements which were known at that time. In fact, he also kept certain vacant spaces for the elements which he predicted to be discovered later. And he also anticipated the properties of these future elements. And when actually those elements were discovered, they showed the similar properties as predicted by Mendeleev. So that way, the work of Mendeleev is very important, very crucial, which actually led to the modern periodic table that we follow in today's time. For the Mendeleev's periodic table, the physical and the chemical properties of elements are the periodic function of their atomic mass. Because at that time, atomic number concept was not there, they only knew about the atomic mass of elements. So he arranged them in the increasing order of atomic mass, and that is how the classification was done. The main features of Mendeleev's periodic table is that he arranged in the horizontal rows, which he called period. There are 7 periods in the periodic table, and there is a regular gradation of properties as one moves from left to right in a particular period. Besides that, there are groups, and there are 8 groups in which the elements were arranged, and the elements of a particular group show similar properties. So these were the main important features of Mendeleev's table. Now let's see the merits of Mendeleev's periodic table. He was able to successfully classify all the 63 elements known at that time. He also left certain blank spaces for the elements to be discovered in future. And when the noble gases were discovered, they were actually put at a separate place without disturbing the arrangement of the Mendeleev's periodic table. Despite all the merits of the Mendeleev's table, there are certain demerits also, which led to further work on the periodic table. The first problem associated with the Mendeleev's periodic table is the position of hydrogen. Now this hydrogen is a very unique element. It resembles both alkali metals as well as halogens. So it was very difficult to find the position or the place of this element, whether to keep it with halogen or with alkali. So that position was very much disputed. Second problem was with the isotopes. As we know that isotopes have different atomic mass, so it was very difficult to find separate place for these isotopes. So that posed another difficulty. There was certain other difficulties or drawbacks which were with nickel and cobalt. There was another problem with manganese that was put in the category of halogens, and that has totally different properties than the halogens. So because of these limitations, these drawbacks, there was a need to further upgrade, further improve the Mendeleev's periodic table, and this is what was done by a scientist called Mosley. And in 1911 he found that it is the atomic number and not the atomic mass which determines the properties of elements. Fortunately, by then a lot of research had been done for structure of atom. It was found that there are electrons revolving around the nucleus, there's a positively charged nucleus having neutrons and protons. So all these things had become known by then, and using these knowledge and this information, the scientist mostly was able to find out the exact reason for difference in properties. And he said that it is atomic number and not the atomic mass, which was the basis of Mendeleev's periodic table, that is responsible for change in properties. And when this atomic number was used to classify the elements, all the drawbacks which were there with Mendeleev's, they automatically disappeared. And today the long form of modern periodic table that we use is actually arranged as per the atomic number of elements, and it has been able to justify and prove all the different properties exhibited by the elements. So if you look at the layout of the modern periodic table, it is not very different from the Mendeleev periodic table. We still have 7 periods, which mean horizontal rows, and there are 18 groups, 1 to 18, and the elements are arranged as per the blocks. We have 4 blocks: S blocks, P blocks, D blocks and F blocks. Group 1 and 2 elements belong to S block because they have either 1 or 2 electrons in their outermost shell. Group 13 to 18 belong to P block elements. They have 3 to 8 electrons in their outermost shell. If you look at their position, they are in the right hand side of the modern periodic table. Group 3 to 12 elements belong to D block, and they have 2 outermost shell incomplete. They are also called transition elements. And group F block elements are those elements in which 3 outermost shells are incomplete. So these F block elements are actually found at the bottom. There are 2 series, lanthanide and actinide, and that is how this classification of elements is done in modern periodic table. And we have 18 group elements which are noble gases. They have completely filled outermost shell. They are the inert gases as well because they do not show any tendency to react with any other elements, so they are placed separately and called noble gases. So with the help of atomic number, modern periodic table was able to completely eliminate the drawbacks of the Mendeleev's table. First, the isotope problem was solved because isotopes have same atomic number, so all the isotopes can be placed at the same position in the modern periodic table. Regarding nickel and cobalt, also the problem was solved because cobalt has less atomic number than nickel, that is why it comes before it. And that is how the modern periodic table has completely justified the properties exhibited by different elements. So another important feature of modern periodic table is that the elements are arranged as per the electronic configuration, how the electrons are arranged in the different shells, and they are also classified as per certain blocks. So with the help of that, there is a lot of clarity of the different properties of the elements, and it is very popular throughout the world because of its usefulness and the different justification it gives to the behavior and properties of the elements. So now let's talk about valency. Valency is nothing but the combining capacity of an element. It depends on total number of valence electrons, means the electrons which are there in the outermost shell. And they are very important because in the chemical reaction, it is the valence electrons which participate and make different changes. So the valency of an element is very important. It decides whether the element is reactive or not. For instance, the first group elements, say sodium and potassium, they have valency 1, which means they have one electron in their outermost shell. They can donate this electron to another element which is short of it, and they can immediately react. So that's why they are so reactive. So valency is very important, which decides the reactivity of the element. Now the next section is atomic size. Now atomic size of an atom is dependent on atomic radius. Now atomic radius is nothing but the distance between the center of the atom to the outermost shell. So if the size of an atom is bigger, then obviously it will have more atomic radius. In the periodic table, as we go down the group, a new shell is added, which means the atomic radius increases, which means the atomic size also increases as we move down the group. Now when we move from left to right in the period, the number of electrons are added, but the shell remains the same, because of which there is a greater electrostatic pull between the nucleus and the valence electrons. As a result, the atomic radius shrinks, and that leads to reduction in size of the atom as we move from left to right. Now the next one is the metallic character. Now metallic character is nothing but the tendency of an element to donate electron, which means it can give its electron to another element which is short of it, and that way it can react. So the more the tendency of an element to donate the electron, the more metallic it is. Now let's see how this varies down the group or from left to right in the period. As we go down the group, the valence electrons are actually far from the nucleus, which means the electrostatic pull is less. In other words, it is easier to knock out that valence electron. So, in other words, as we move down the group, the metallic character increases. Now, let's see from left to right. As we move from left to right, the valence electrons are actually tightly packed, and it is not easy to knock them out. So that leads to the metallic character getting diminished as we move from left to right. So metallic character increases down the group, decreases from left to right. If we take non-metallic character, it is just the reverse of metallic character, which means the non-metallic character decreases down the group and it increases from left to right. So this is all about the first chapter, School of Elements. If you like this video, please subscribe to my channel and also comment on it. It will help me improve my further videos. Thanks a lot for watching my channel.